regional model, Government Law College International Moot Court Competition 2016.
Late Mr. D.M. Harish dedicated himself with great fervor to the pursuit of academic excellence in the law as a discipline. Self-sacrificing and humble, he was a non-believer in mediocrity. He was one of the most exceptional and gifted lawyers whose goodwill has outlived him. He remains in everyone's heart as one of the most respected and distinguished professionals to have graced this coveted profession. And hence, it is only fitting that India's most prestigious moot court competition is a tribute to this distinguished legal legend without whose extensive contribution the field of law would be incomplete.
The Government Law College Moot Court Association has been hosting the D.M. Harish Memorial International Moot Court Competition for over a decade, supported significantly by the D.M. Harish Foundation. This competition provides law students across the globe a platform to delve into important branches of international law and the complexities surrounding it. On behalf of the Government Law College, Moot Court Association and the D.M. Harish Foundation, we warmly welcome you all to the panel discussion of the 17th D.M. Harish Memorial Government Law College International Moot Court Competition 2016.
The competition was made international in the year 2005, making it India's first international moot court competition. This year's edition marks the 12th year when the competition will see international teams participating on a global platform.
The late Mr. D.M. Harish was a distinguished advocate and a renowned authority on income tax law. His exemplary academic career saw him obtain a first rank in the matriculation examination. After the partition of India, Mr. Harish came to Mumbai and joined the Government Law College. Here, he began to strike new roots as a professional in the field of law after securing his law degree with the highest honours.
Today, it is a matter of great pride that we take his name as an esteemed member of our illustrious alumni, or his station itself. It is over 161 years old. Government Law College continues the legacy and quality of excellence. Over the years, Government Law College has created the perfect atmosphere for holistic education, blending heritage and tradition with the contemporary. It continues to churn out excellent lawyers who have maintained and upheld the integrity of the legal.
Kindness and cooperation go a long way to ensure excellence in all our endeavors. I now request our principal to deliver the welcome address.
Good evening, everyone. Respected panelists, moderator Mr. Harish Jatian, professors and participants. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all to the panel discussion for the 17th D.M. Harish Memorial Government Law College International Moot Court Competition 2016 on the issue of trial by media. First of all, I welcome Senior Counsel Ram Jethwaran, the Bhishmacharya among the legal luminaries. He is known as Maverick Lawyer and is a member of high profile defense cases to his credit as a lawyer. He has served as India's Union Law Minister and as also Chairman of Bar Council of India. He is also a part-time professor at Government Law College, Mumbai. We are proud of him. I am highly impressed by his life journey that I just read in his book, Biography, The River. He is a legend. I recommend law students to read this book, which is Guide to the Law Students. Next panelist, Sri Milind Deora, was member of the 15th Lok Sabha, the Lower House of Parliament of India, from the Mumbai South constituency. He is the former Minister of State with the Ministry of Information Technology and Communication, and the former Minister of State with the Ministry of Shipping within the Government of India. Sri Kumar Kefkar doesn't require introduction. He is a senior journalist He has also been the editor of chief. He is also editor in chief of Marathi newspaper Lok Satta and worked for the Economic Times and Maharashtra Times. He has been recipient of Padma Shri Awards. Mr. Amit K. Desai is a senior advocate. He is an alumnus of our college. He works on matters relating to saving, Prevention of Corruption Act, Indian Penal Code, Foreign Exchange Regulations, Extradictions, Company Law, etc. Mr. Anand Goenka oversees the Express Group's Business Publication Division. Goenka is a Dean Scholar in Print Journalism from the Amendor School of Journalism, Los Angeles, USA. Last is Harish Chaktan. He has extensive litigation and arbitration experience. He is trustee at the DHH Foundation. I welcome all the dignitaries. Today's subject of panel discussion, all of you are well aware that it is trial by media, when we speak about trial by media, we have to understand that there are two sides, one positive and one negative. There are many Supreme Court judgments varying the practice of publishing the articles. And comments of the victims' relatives in the newspaper. There are so many cases in MP Rohia versus State of West Bengal, in Burksale versus State of Kerala. The High Court has observed that the practice of investigative officer briefing to the media about the progress of the investigation is highly deprecated. It was held that the truth is often suppressed, exaggerated or distorted in order to add flavor and spice to the story and fickle-minded public, which might be conditioned to believe a particular version given through a calculated process of media. My friends, at the same time, speakers on positive side may say that every person has natural craving for the truth. Can we say that courts are the only institutions which cherishes the truth? Should the craving of truth be restricted to the court alone? More particularly when we knew that no institution can be perfect. We accept the court's decision as binding, but not as the truth. What is truth? It is an unanswered question till date. Judicial system means it includes police, prosecutor, defense, witnesses, lawyers, and finally judge. The deficiency is neglect, corruption, nepotism. Each of the factor constitutes untrue input slip of judge, and the decision based on such untrue input may be far away from the truth. And therefore, any prudent person can say that why there should be bar for other institutions like media exploring the possibility of finding out the truth in their own way. I will not take much time from here. You are very eager to listen the speakers. I would like to commend the efforts of the Moot Court Association for organizing the panel discussion, and would hope that the discussion would keep the audience interested and would simulate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. As a gesture symbolic with India's rich heritage and diverse culture, the ceremonial lamp is lit to auspiciously commence the event with the blessings of the Almighty and to spread the noble purpose of education. I now request Mr. Anil Harish, trustee of the DM Harish Foundation, our Principal Judge Pramod Ambekar, as well as our Chairman Professor Dilip Shinde, to kindly escort our dignitaries on the dais to light the ceremonial lamp.
The official competition souvenir is released each year to commemorate and archive the exclusivity of each edition of this prestigious competition. I now request Mr. Ramjay Panani, Senior Advocate of the Supreme Court of India, to kindly release the official competition souvenir and give an introductory speech on the topic.
Just now, not getting up. I will get up after a little while when these speeches have brought back my lost energy. And I think you will be very, very happy to hear the kind of speeches. And each one of the persons sitting with me on this stage is a giant in his profession. And be sure that. That is why I have told them that I will speak last. And thank you, thank you.
Sir, the souvenir, please.
Each year, the DM Harish Memorial International Moot Court Competition is inaugurated by witnessing a panel discussion on a contemporary issue of international significance. The conclave for this edition of the competition deals with diplomatic protection, safe passage, and extradition. The topic for this year's panel discussion is trial by media.
I now request the moderator for the evening, Mr. Harish Chaudhary, Senior Advocate, Bombay High Court, to commence with the evening's discussion and introduce our esteemed panelists for today. Please, sir.
Good evening. I'd like to just outline as to how this panel discussion will proceed and make a few opening remarks, and then, of course, I'll set a few questions to each of the panelists, and then expect it to become interactive. And at the end, with some time left over, I'll throw it open to the floor so that you can, in your turn, ask questions and nominate the panelists that you would wish to deal with that question of yours. Now, the topic of the discussion is trial by media. The trial by media has become a daily hazard, with media activism hitting such intimidating decibel levels on the ostensible ground that the nation wants to know. Today, for a change, let's put the media on trial and let the panelists be the judge of evaluating the role of the media. Media may be categorized into the following, namely print, electronic, and social, which is the internet. And each one of them has its own characteristics. Now, the print media, that's the newspapers, by their very nature, are stark, no visuals, no colors, no images, no action. Now, the newspapers lend themselves naturally to an in-depth analysis, essays, discussions, editorials, research, and sustained dissemination of information on a given topic over a period of time. Newspapers tend to acquire an editorial policy, as Mr. Ketkar will tell you. That's an editorial culture which acquires over a period of time, depending upon its internal policy and values. However, the print media is not generally interactive with its readers, barring, of course, the limited feedback that you get by letters to the editor. The electronic media, that's a television, on the other hand, is a high impact and in the face medium because it is financed by commercial business houses which demand a wide viewership. Hence, the focus of the TV channels is on breaking news, controversial news items, and the activities of celebrities and politicians so that they can increase the TRP levels. This, therefore, would tend to compromise on the quality of the news and research on investigative journalism. Sensationalism sells itself, and therefore a topic that ceases to be sensational or not newsworthy is often dropped. That the medium caters to an audience with a limited attention span, you know, the audience, each one of them is equipped with a remote in his hand, and so you, if you don't like a news channel, you just switch channels. However, television is an interactive medium, particularly in the way in which channel now promotes discussions, debates, interviews, etc. And it's a powerful medium that can either stimulate the expeditious dispensation of justice by making the system accountable, or can seriously interfere with the course of trial of a judiciary by holding a parallel trial. Now, the social media or the internet has the widest reach that's connecting the whole world in an instant. The internet is capable of starting a revolution, as in fact has been exemplified by the Arab Spring. While Golan, now this is something quite revealing, while Golan, that's an Egyptian Google employee, was so moved by the killing of a 29-year-old Egyptian protester by the police under the Hosni Mubarak regime, that he posted a picture of this boy's body and called it, the boy's name was Khalid Said, and he posted it saying, "We are all Khalid Said." Now, this post went so viral that it struck a chord with millions of young Egyptians, which eventually brought down the Hosni Mubarak regime. But Ghanem, in a TED post some years later, had this to say about the internet, that whilst the net may start a revolution, it is not capable of giving birth to a true democratic alternative because it cannot sustain and harness the fervor that it has generated. You know what happened? After Hosni Mubarak, the Muslim Brotherhood took over, and after that, the military rule has taken over, that which is now governing Egypt. Now, highlighting the destructive tendencies, he summed it up by saying the following five destructive tendencies of the net. First, he said, the net cannot deal with rumors which confirm the people's biases and are believed and spread amongst millions of people. So you can't contain rumors. Second, he said that the net user only communicates with people who agree with the user, for you may use the mute button, the unfollow or block everybody. Third, he says, the discussions descend into angry mobs. Fourth, he said that opinions cannot be easily changed because of the speed and brevity which denies a deep conversation. That is 140 characters, as you know, in Twitter. And fifthly, he said that this media favors, I quote, favors broadcasting over engagement, posts over discussions, shallow comments over deep conversations, and if we agree that we are here, to talk at each other instead of talking with each other. Then he went on to say, today I believe that if we want to liberate society, we first need to liberate the internet. Now the existence of the media is entirely premised on a free society or free speech, which is guaranteed under Article 19, as you know. And this has evolved into the freedom of the press. This freedom, however, often clashes and interferes with the life and liberty, and also with the right of privacy, and is largely a matter of self-regulation by the media to operate within the rule of law and bounds of reason, but equally essential for that society to have a robust administrative system, which includes the judiciary. The media, as such, has two primary roles: to investigate into the truth of a topic and to energize and mold and inform public opinion. In this panel discussion, we need not limit ourselves to cases that are being tried in a court of law, but the larger role of the media, that is, in focusing on topics of public interest which touch the lives of people, such as elections, divisive politics, etc. The Delhi High Court, in a recent case concerning the documentary on the Nirbhaya case, rape case, has delayed the releasing or the airing of the documentary until the Supreme Court decides the appeal, observing that earlier media had a self-imposed code of conduct in not reporting sub judice matters, but now the media has thrown that to the winds. So with these opening remarks, I may now begin the panel discussion. And my first question would go to Mr. Ram Jaipurani. Ram, you were one of the champions of free speech during the Indira Gandhi emergency, which saw complete gagging of the press. Now, if you had to choose between the two extremes, that is, no free press or an unchecked freedom, what would be your response?
I would certainly prefer the freedom of speech. And if a person is not free to speak, be sure that there would never have been what we call the great, great price that we today have paid for, and democracy would never have come into existence. Democracy is the greatest gift which exists now under the Constitution of India. And I believe that it is imperative for this freedom to be continued with the fullest possible extent, and the limitation of that freedom should be as minimum as possible. And that is why you find that the Constitution of India, in the first Article 19 of the Constitution, put freedom of speech in Clause 1. It was Clause A of 19(1) of the Constitution of India, which talks of the freedom of speech and expression. If this freedom is to be restricted, it is obvious that it must be restricted upon some very, very, very strict grounds and weighty grounds. And that is why, when you read the whole of Article 19 of the Constitution, you find that in Clause 2 of Article 19, the subjects which are talked about as subjects in the interests of which restrictions on free speech can be imposed are the security of India, all kinds of public morality and so on, and one of them is contempt of court. Now that tells you ultimately that the major concern is the freedom which is guaranteed by 19(1) of the Constitution of India, and it is only an exception, which is clause number 2, that gives you exceptional circumstances in which Parliament alone can legislate restrictions on freedom of speech. I believe that the best way of creating a dictatorship is to take away the right of public criticism of those who are in power. And today, I must plead guilty to belonging to a class of persons who have turned out to be the most despicable class in this country, and that is politicians. So, if there were no politicians left at all who exercised the freedom of speech, the unruly politicians who have no respect for anybody except their own welfare and their own riches and economic success, you will find that freedom will be lost forever and will never be revived again until you fight and fight as we have fought for the establishment of democracy for thousands and thousands of years. So I think the answer to your question is that freedom of expression, speech, shall always prevail, and it will be subject only to some minimum restrictions which has to be justified in the interests of the people themselves. And thank you.
Thank you. Now, I'd like to move to more specifics. Maybe talk about how the licentiousness that some of the TV channels have reduced themselves to. But we come back to the need. And let me just now address my next question to a very renowned journalist, an analyst, Mr. Kumar. Now, your renown is on account of being an investigative journalist, and you have several schools to your credit. Dr. Kumar, my question to you is, to what extent do you think that a newspaper like yours should exercise self-restraint in holding back sensitive information, as it may lead to disrupt public order? And conversely also, while you're answering this, are there instances when newspapers protect lobbies that support them by suppressing news that is prejudicial to their interest?
Well, actually it is necessary to distinguish between different media, because the topic trial by media became hot only after electronic journalism, mainly the television private channels, started shouting at the top of their voice, and all the panels were having shouting matches, and the nation's supposed to know, are expected to know only from them. So the nation was supposed to know only from the panel discussions and not in the newspapers. Actually, trial by media used to be there even before. Mr. Ram Jethmalani is here himself, Indian Express is also represented by Sharan Goenka. There was no private channel TV in the 1970s, and the powers that be, led by Indira Gandhi or later even by Janata Party, they were saying that it was trial by media. Mrs. Indira Gandhi declared emergency and had a censorship because she thought that the press, that the media was against him. At that time, there was no 24/7 TV and there was no other person. And yet the media was considered to be trying the powers that be. So trial by media today has become such a hot topic because the television is so strong. But let me also tell you that all the people who attend and regularly participate or actually watch or hear the television news, that number is extremely miserably small. The total percentage of people, total percentage of all population people, according to all advertising agencies and television monitors, is less than 5% of the 135 crore people. Only 5% watch TV. Of these 5%, they include all Hindi, English, Marathi, Tamil, everybody. And the English channels are watched or heard only by less than 1%. So the idea of politicians or others getting tormented by the media is actually limited to very, very small portion of the people, and rest of the people are watching films or entertainment channels or National Geographic or Animal Planet. So prefer to watch actual animals rather than. Therefore, this trial by media is becoming a hot topic only because of certain channels are actually going hyperbolic and going overboard. But let me also tell you that even that is going to have a very limited impact now. Just about 2-3 years ago, actually this trial by media began with 26/11. Till 2008, 26/11, nobody talked of channels so much. It's only after that, so it's only 6 years or 8 years. And Facebook is only 12 years. Twitter is only 6 years. And yet we are talking of social media as the most powerful medium. So electronic media has already been sidelined by the social media, and electronic media when it came actually tried to sideline the print. But your question was more about the print, so I would like to answer that. In print, maybe there is only one column or two columns readers let us, but in print there is much more scope for discussion because there are so many other articles which are not letters to the editor. Then there is a counter view, this view, that view, people's interviews, and so many other aspects are there in the newspaper. So it is not only limited to the readers. Unlike on television, there is nothing like a structured editorial with a structured argument. There will be 5 talking heads sitting in front of the anchor, and everybody is given 30 seconds to 45 seconds to answer the most important question of foreign relations or particular relations with Pakistan. And so it is completely out of the loop for the television media to keep people involved except in listening, except in watching. And therefore, I think we should not unnecessarily give over importance to the media, despite so much of censorship. When the elections came in 1977, Mrs. Gandhi's party was routed, almost all India except South India. Despite so much of popularity of Janata Party, in 2.5 years, Mrs. Gandhi came back, despite opposition by the media. Entire media in 1980 elections was opposed to Indira Gandhi. And yet, Indira Gandhi came back. In 1984, Rajiv Gandhi had stunning seats of 414, and there was no electronic media, there was no Arnab Goswami, no Barkhadat, no Rajiv Sarasai, and yet in 1989, he was reduced to 197 seats in Lok Sabha. All that happened because the press was free, press was strident, maybe press was biased. Yes, it is biased. Press cannot be completely unbiased because no institution can be completely unbiased, no person can be absolutely unbiased, and media person cannot be expected to be totally unbiased. Objectivity is a myth created by non-participants in the media. There is nothing like absolute objectivity. You have to have a worldview, you have to have a perspective. When that perspective becomes a bias to a party or a person, then it becomes objectionable. But otherwise, as far as describing the situation, describing the environment, describing the conditions concerned, I think that perspective is limited. The same economy that we are witnessing today, some people consider it is growing, beautifully growing, and India has excellent future. And same, another number of economists say that we are in trouble. Same facts, the facts are same and the interpretations are different. I think the beauty of the print media is that it can play actually all the multiple views which television cannot. To a certain extent, social media was expected to, but social media cannot because social media is more interested in forwarding and liking rather than actually discussing the issue. And therefore, print remains the major medium of exchange of ideas, exchange of views. Unfortunately, exchange of ideas is going down these days, as even the intelligentsia is taking more interest in sensational aspects rather than intellectual dimensions.
I'm not here to know as a politician and ask him whether he agrees or confirms what Kumar Ketkar has just said. Dilip, you were the minister in charge of technology in the previous government. Now, the question to you is, do you think that the Congress campaign for the 2014 elections through the social media was wholly ineffective, considering that Congress was reduced to double digits? And correspondingly, do you think that the NDA made much better use of this media? And whilst you're answering this, I'd like you to also keep a focus on the 2019 elections. Do you think you'll do things any differently?
It's a political question. It has very little to do with travel of media. But let me at the outset say that I'm fortunate to be one of maybe a handful of politicians who still hasn't faced a trial by media. When I was a minister in this department, traditionally as a government, the way governments are structured, media essentially is regulated and driven from a government side by the IND ministry. But as a minister of communications and IT, I was really responsible for the ministry that was behind a new media, which I believe in future, as technology is evolving, will actually displace print, television, even the internet and social media as we know it today. We talk of Facebook, we talk of Twitter. In my opinion, will change radically. And I think that's the good news for those who are opposed to media trial, because the internet is becoming more democratic. It's making media far more open, less driven by corporate interests, and it's breaking down the barriers and disintermediating between the media owner and the content aggregator and ultimately the protagonist behind the story. I just think when we talk of a trial by media, I think India is in a sense in an evolutionary process right now. At one level, there's a major transformation that has taken place in governance, perhaps in the last decade, when Right to Information was enacted in 2005. I had the opportunity of initiating that debate in the Lok Sabha. In fact, as a minister in charge of communications and IT, I was piloting the government's e-governance program, which in another level will actually augment what RTI has done to break barriers. But as media is getting more and more sensational, I personally feel India, like Western democracies, will have to find its balance. Wherein that will really be driven by public opinion and by the viewer. Coming to your question about the elections in 2014, I have no hesitation in admitting that my party had many people have said many things to me in terms of why we lost and why we did so poorly, and there are obviously several reasons to it. But one of the most critical reasons, I believe, as someone who was in government at the time, was we were very ineffective communicators. And I think so much of what we're seeing the government do today are essentially repackaged schemes that we initiated 5, 7, 8 years ago. And that's a good thing. I think it's good that this government is able to repackage them better than us and sell them to the public. But to answer your second question, will we do it better in 2009? I'm hopeful of that we will do it much better in 2019, sorry. And as Mr. Kumar Ketkar said, that you can never rule out a politician and you can never rule out a political party. I think 2 years ago when Mr. Modi came to power and became Prime Minister of India, when I would meet people socially at dinners and at parties, they would say, "Milind, forget about Congress coming to power for another decade." And today people tell me something very different. So politics is always evolving. It's Mr. Jethmalani says he's one of them. But politics, as we know, is very dynamic, and like the media itself, I often say that the only thing more disruptive than the internet is Indian politics.
Amit, let me turn to you now with something more specific. You know, you deserve all the compliments for the Salman Khan trial succeeding. And I read the judgment. I couldn't agree more. I think it's extremely well written and very well reasoned. And I totally subscribe to the view that he absolutely deserved an acquittal. That's my understanding. However, in recent times, if ever a judgment has been castigated on pure lack of understanding of the Evidence Act, purely on suspicion, it is this judgment. Now, obviously, because there's a superstar involved, and that's Salman Khan, probably you as well. Now, I want your perception and your how vulnerable you think the judiciary is when exposed to this sort of talk, because you know, I'm probably. In corridors, you even give it a, you know, I mean, you can imagine what could be said about this, particularly, of course, the proximity of the judge retiring shortly after the judgment, so people read into it. But we know that you're a person of thorough integrity, and of course, I also know that this judge in question is a person of complete integrity. Now the matter is pending before the Supreme Court. What's your take on all this?
You know, one of the first comments I made once the judgment was out was, of course, that it was professionally satisfying. But the reason why I said that was that this was after a three-month argument before the judge, where virtually every 3 days I had to remind the judge of the settled legal principles that we need to decide in the four walls of this room on the basis of the evidence and law laid down by the courts, and not on the basis of what you read in the newspapers. And that constant reminder, I often was hauled up by friends in the media saying, why do you sort of keep going after us every now and then? But I think that's the reality of these kind of cases. We've seen this, in fact, Ram has had, through the entire, his share of all these kind of media cases. He went through the personal experience in the Jessica Lal case, and any matter which is of a celebrity, high profile businessman is taken up by the media, sensationalized, and only to generate TRP. So while Kumar says that in the print media there is a lot more structured debate, I think there was a lot more structured debate in the past. When I look at it from the time, the cases that I'm dealing with, which get reported in the media, I don't see a debate. I see sensationalism, I see TRPs. You see this on the electronic channels. I'll give a small example here about the Salman case and what the media does to institutions. The day on which he was granted bail, because the judgment copy was not available, and this is something which is done normally in these kind of matters, the court said, all right, till the judgment copy is available, I release you on bail, because the law is very well settled. And if you are on bail all through the trial, your bail will continue. And if you don't have a copy of the judgment, then we will continue the bail till the judgment is available, the copy is available. But the court was cautious in keeping the matter after 2 days. He didn't sort of keep it after 3 months. And when the judgment was received, again, there was a huge debate that why was preference given? Why was he released on bail? Is it because he was a celebrity that he was released on bail? The media doesn't follow the law. The media and the journalists do not appreciate what the law is. And they castigated the institution, denigrated in my submission the institution, by the comments that were made when the court was only following the settled legal principles. The court made an observation saying that the question as to whether it's a case of 304A, which is a much more minor offense compared to a culpable homicide charge, is a matter which needs to be examined. Now, 304A case is a bailable offense. So the normal rule in such cases is the court would grant bail. But when you look at this, and what happened to the institution? Because the media, electronic, print, and social did not understand the legal principles. And what it did was it actually brought down the respect for the institution. So when we talk about media trials, and this was my own personal experience, that's the reason why for months on end, I had to keep reminding the court. And fortunately, knowing the judge and his background in criminal law, he spent many years doing trials, we were able to at least get him to steer away from the outside pressures that take control of decisions and thinking. But you know, it's often said, we often keep as lawyers say that no, we judges, when we judge, we are just above and we have the ability to be impartial and objective about it. Lord Dillon rightly put it, he said that judicial superiority cannot overtake human frailty. And that's a reality. And somewhere in the subconscious, all this keeps working. Small example again, the session judge convicted him for 5 years. On what criteria, on what principle? Nobody knows. Was it the subconscious which the media carried, which prompted him to give him 5 years? Whereas in the cases of Alistair Pereira and Sanjeev Nanda, where the number of people who died were more, the punishment for 2 years and 3 years. So you don't know where all this comes into the stream of judging. And that's where, when we talk about trial by media, I for one have seen the impact of this impact of media opinions and public opinions that are generated through inadequate understanding of the law, which unnecessarily create suspicions. In fact, I might just add one small comment here, Harish, is that we talk about the whole concept of acquittal as one aspect of trying to redeem one's dignity and respect. But what happens with this kind of public opinion that's created through media is that in today's day and age, I don't think an acquittal of a court actually redeems one's reputation or dignity. All that it does is it takes that human being out of the clutches of the judicial system. But he's always, when he walks around, he's viewed with suspicion. And that is the problem about some of these.
Thank you. That's very, very clear, because really speaking, it's running the institution down. And if we had a robust institution in that sense, which was beyond suspicion, perhaps much of this would not happen. I also wish to remind the panelists here that you're free to come in on any response which has been given by another panelist and take it from there, because I just wanted to initiate the discussion by asking an initial question, but thereafter it could be interactive. May I just get Anand Goenka in it, and then I won't cover it.
I wish
you get an opportunity.
No, I wish you told me earlier, because I disagreed 80% of what you said to start, for your first comments.
Let me
Mr. Desai, just responding to the last comment there. Look, I think to think that a judge is going to be influenced by media coverage is being very unfair to the judge, is my view as a publisher and as a citizen. We do not have a jury system in this country. There's a reason for that, I guess. A judge is somebody who is, I believe, trained to not be influenced by what the media has to say. I don't think any judge is watching Arnab Goswami writing the judgment or is reading the next editorial writing the judgment.
Arnab is watching him.
As far as the judicial process is concerned, as far as the actual hearing, I think that's grossly overstated. There's a lot been said against the media, and I'm going to struggle to defend all of it, because I think quite often experts seem to be there, because we try to be, we want to believe that we are the exception. But I have of the view that the loudest cries of trial by media seem to come from public figures, of almost always corrupt politicians, defaulting businessmen, what have you. So our job, I don't think, can stop because of the chance that one report might influence a judgment. I think that's making it very unfair to our role and also the ability of the judge. Let me just, since everybody said some pretty negative things about media, I'll just take one sort of positive side. Priyadarshi Matu's case. An IPS officer, son, Santosh Kumar, was accused of murdering her and was acquitted because of lack of evidence. The additional session judge said that he was forced to acquit Santosh Kumar, even though he knew that this was, quote, this was the man who committed the crime. He even said that the rule of law doesn't seem to apply to the children of those who enforce it. Now, when this judge went on record to call out the CBI for being unable to produce a key witness to the murder, the Indian Express dispatched its reporter Sonal Manchanda to Bihar. She took a 5-hour taxi ride from Patna and knocked on the door of the key witness, who said no one came to look for me. I personally, I feel so proud to say that most possibly it was his statements in the Indian Express was a key driver in the case, which was eventually reopened and due to media attention eventually led to his conviction. There are many more such cases, I can keep listing them out here. In fact, just today there was one in the Indian Express, but I won't sort of get distracted there. I think, globally, good journalists and good journalism, the most longest lasting institutional journalism, have always been founded on the principle that we want to change the world. It's not to make money, it's not for a salary. And in Priyadarshini Mathew's case, I think good journalism prevailed and there was a world that changed for the victim's family, for the CBI. So there was a very impactful sort of effect of journalism there. So I think there is a good role that we do, which is being completely missed out. Having said all of that, I do think TV is a little bit under the influence of social media, which is a tricky one to ignore. Because I think media feels very vulnerable with the role of the advent of digital. When I started running digital for Indian Express, I was told to do well on digital, you have to do ABCD. Astrology, Bollywood, cricket, and devotion. So that the tenets of journalism seem to be becoming the question. And often media starts to try to compete with the speed of social media and accuracy seems to be going out of the window. So I think there's a lot more work we can do, but I think generally we've been doing a good job, and I think over time we've only gotten better, more professional, and far more transparent.
Well, that's fine.
Let me just clarify what I was intending to just communicating. I think the media does a great job in uncovering the deficiencies of the investigating agencies. I don't think there's a problem about that. That's part of your role. I think the issue that I was addressing was not about that aspect of the way in which the media runs it. It's about the way in which articles are written. It's the sensationalism that comes into the article. So long as it's a question of fact, it's a mere report, there can be no debate or dispute about it. So the example that you gave, that they couldn't find the witness, and when you dispatched your reporters, you found the witness, brought that fact out. That was a deficiency in the investigating agency's conduct, and that's fine. But what is happening and what does happen is sometimes the slants, the innuendos that creep into these articles, which create the public opinion. And there can be no doubt and debate, if that's the way the law of this country allows to settle it, there can be no doubt and debate that reporting, factual reporting is fine. Sting operations are also fine. But it is when you come in with the innuendos, when you come in with the slant, when you come in with the angles, which is what creates the suspicion, which is what creates the public opinion. That is the problem, and I must tell you that even in this case, in the High Court, it became necessary for us to first get an order from the court before the hearing began that the reporting shall be only factual and there be no comments. And it is only because we got that order that the reporting was purely factual as to what was going on in the court.
If I just not confined to trials, Anand, I want to ask you this, because you were the interviewer in Amir Khan in that famous interview of his. I think it was on the context of award Vapsi and also the Dadri lynching. Now, he expressed a view with that there was an atmosphere of intolerance, and he also, I think, quoted his wife saying that, we'd be better off leaving this country. Whatever, it was an emotional outburst. Now, the media in that sense, particularly Arnab Goswami, just completely went to town. Also, in his panel discussions, he gave a communal tone to it. Now all this was in the, exactly what Amit said, innuendos, things like that directly. Now when Amit Khan said that, I personally think it was contextual. It was in a particular setting, and it's not that when he said that there is an atmosphere of intolerance, you can't really say he's wrong, because there is BC intolerance from time to time. So how do you explain the conduct of the media in the context of this particular episode?
So the Amir Khan piece, I won't say much because I was part of that episode. So I won't.
So I want you to say something.
So I'm trying not to have a view on that very hard. I think, when I sort of And okay, I think let's sort of be clear about the fact that when somebody of the stature and the sort of fame of Amir Khan speaks, everybody listens. And so I think when you get a personality like Amir Khan to make a statement like that, there will be people who listen, and it will sort of get carried across the board. I don't expect to be carried for 48 hours of TV continuously on all channels. I don't expect that. But certainly, there would have repercussions. Now, it's very interesting. I think it's a Bombay-Delhi divide, because I go to Delhi 2 days a week, every week, religiously. And all my friends in Delhi, they saw that interview, and when he said that, they said, how could he say that? What a scoop, huge story, big statement, etc., etc. And everybody in Bombay said, innocuous, it was emotional outburst. So I think, I guess we are living in a little bit more politically sensitive time. And so I think small statements, big statements, any statements made by people who have a certain following will be sort of amplified more than you might have expected maybe 20, 30 years ago.
I think we pay too much attention to the chatting classes, and chatting classes are the audience of the television debates. And that's why we think that the noise that television channels make, these panel discussions, is actually getting reflected in the print. Therefore, I just wanted to say to Mr. Desai that yes, it is true that even print media has become sensational, but even then, take for instance the juvenile crime story. All the print media, newspapers, all the newspapers questioned even the parliament decision on juvenile crime, whereas television was completely going gaga. Similarly, LGBT, all the print media was extremely rational, extremely just. It was not playing to the gallery which television was. So print media, by its very nature, you go to bed at the print press at about 12 o'clock and nothing happens till next day's 12 o'clock. Whereas television 24/7 is actually forcing you to react to everything. So even the newsrooms in the print media get influenced to a certain extent by electronic media and nowadays even by social media. But overall, there is more rationality, more structured debate, more structured articles in the print than in the television, because in television there is nothing like that. The medium is not meant for that. Actually, social media can replace the good aspect of the print media, but it has not. So, only point I want to make was what Alan was saying, that I have not criticized media. I said I am not party to the, though I can be, because I am inside and I know that media definitely has a lot to answer for. But even then, in the section of the media, I think print media still keeps rationality and justness and to a certain extent objectivity in opinions as well as in news.
Yeah, I actually wanted to talk about exactly that how quickly the parliament passed the Juvenile Justice Act, and there was a big distinction between the way the print media was talking about it and the electronic media. But, to sort of agree on what Anand is saying, which is media obviously has played a very important role in making our society more transparent, and kudos to them for doing that. But I also agree with Mr. Desai's point about institutions potentially, in certain cases, getting weakened, getting even bypassed. The most glaring example of that is in the 2G case, for instance, when the CAG made a presentation, and there have been multiple CAG reports that have been presented to Parliament well before 2G, well before coal. There was always a process that has been followed and has been laid out by the Constitution. CAG presents its report, audits the books of the government. That report then goes to the Public Accounts Committee of Parliament, which is a multi-party group of MPs who verify his findings. And then that becomes the rule of law, that this is what the loss has been to the Exchequer. And even within that, you can argue why there was a potential loss to the Exchequer. Maybe the government wanted to improve tele-density over revenue. But I remember when the CAG said that the loss to the Exchequer, the potential loss to the Exchequer, if the government had decided to auction spectrum, would have been 1,76,000 crores. Before the PAC could even deliberate on that finding, and later after the PAC's deliberation, they corrected that figure and established it as, I think, around 50,000 crores. And the government also explained that we chose tele-density, we chose greater mobile connectivity at lower fares over increasing revenue. But the way the media lapped it up was that the corruption in the country and on this particular issue was worth 1,76,000 crores. And that sensationalized the issue that obviously led to ministers, some of whom I believe should have resigned in any case and been sacked in any case. But in some ways it undermines institutions. And like Amit Desai pointed out, in Salman's case, perhaps it was a judiciary, but it could be the CAG in this case. And that's something where, as a society, as legislators, as the judiciary, as media, as citizens, we have to be extremely careful not to allow those institutions and the institutional process and framework to be undermined.
Can I just supplement what Mr. Desai said, or little nugget that I'm aware of?
Is that whilst the media, of course, raised that issue of 1,76,000 crores, interestingly, in the charge sheet that was filed by the CBI, they also pegged the figure at 1,76,000 crores. But so for that one particular transaction for which the case was filed, the figure might be just a few thousand crores. So what it did, the media reports influenced the investigative process, influenced the investigation machinery, as a result of which they actually took that number before a court in order to create an impact so far as the court is concerned. So that's also something, because ultimately an investigating agency must actually be very clear about what is the loss and what is the charge qua those set of individuals who are being brought before the court for trial.
Yeah, just one quick point is that I wanted to, the Indian Express spent 2 months questioning that very number, 1,76,000 crores, because it was just too big a number. It was very easy, it was an easy number, it was a sexy headline, but it was just a very great number put up.
And I can tell you, as someone who's been a minister in this very department, there was a strong case to be made, and there still is. Today, if you look at telecom tariffs and what they call ARPUs, average revenue per user, it's increased a lot. And as a result, tele-density in India, especially in rural areas, is slowing down. And when the decision not to auction spectrum wasn't taken under Manmohan Singh's government, it was taken, in fact, when Vajpayee was Prime Minister. But very few people in India even knew that. They thought it was Manmohan Singh's government that took that decision, and that was a scam. And in fact, it's Vajpayee's decision, all credit to him, in 2003 when he took the decision not to auction spectrum, which when we came to power in 2004 and continued that policy, that has led to massive tele-density in our country, where we boast people who are connected to mobile phones and the internet. But with very little debate, and in fact with judicial overreach, in one shot, spectrum has been auctioned now. And the impact of spectrum being auctioned on the consumer and on tele-density will in fact be felt 3 or 5 years later. So my concern is, sometimes without a discussion, debate, public debate in parliament, you don't take a decision, judiciary intervenes, a decision is taken, and then the impact will be felt by the next generation. And that's something that really concerns me.
In fact, Ram, I'd like to draw you into the discussion that's just happening right now. You know, the criminal judicial justice system is that you prove a person's guilt beyond reasonable doubt. But the media really is given to emotions, appealing to the people's emotions rather than that. So that's the trial that they conduct. I'd like to know from you, as a lawyer who has handled many high-profile and sensitive cases, you know, what are the challenges that you have faced on account of this negative publicity generated by the media?
Well, I must tell you that there is a difference in the attitudes of the bosses of the press and the ordinary workers who are collecting news for them. I have often given answers to young people who have come to me and asked me questions. I give them my answers, but I tell them that, listen, if you publish these letters, the answer that I have given you, I will pay you a public compliment, but I assure you that your bosses will not permit this publication. And that has invariably happened. But on the other hand, with all its faults, the press freedom must be preserved, and it is the duty of every citizen to support good people who are running very, very powerful press organs, and we must fight to the finish to see that press freedom is completely restored and no corrupt politician can put any screw upon these bosses for publishing the truth. On the other hand, we are talking about trial by media. Now, trial by media arises out of two articles of the Constitution. It is a conflict between two articles of the Constitution. The first is Article 19(1)(a), which talks of the freedom of expression and freedom of speech. In absolutely no conditions indicated there. But when you come to Clause 2, which talks of the restrictions which Parliament can put on the freedom of speech of people, you will find that the subjects on which freedom of speech can be restricted by Parliament are so weighty, like defense of India and so on and so forth. But one thing which is mentioned amongst the exceptional situations which can lead to control of freedom of expression is contempt of court. Now, contempt of court is also designed to ensure freedom of an accused person from any kind of prohibitions which arise out of, not right, really out of evidence in the case, or creditworthy evidence in the case, but arise out of the public publicity that the press has done on a particular side of the version of facts, and which somehow some judges are not able to control. Today, fortunately, the jury trial has been abolished long ago now in India. Though when I started my practice, there was a trial by jury in most important cases. And believe you me, that what is now happening, no jury trial would have been a fair trial ever. And today, the press has really gone haywire, and Mr. Arnab Goswami is a typical example. And then he calls people, I used to go now to every, I have stopped for years for responding to the invitation to go and participate, because ultimately he wants only to tell the people what he thinks, and he also doesn't think right on many occasions.
I would like to turn to you. You know, one of the roles that the media performs is, or should, is investigating into the... Now, I want to know your views on sting operations. Now, would you justify them at any cost in the quest of truth? That is, even if gathering such material requires invasion of privacy or other illegal means? You know, I'd like to know your views.
There cannot be an absolute answer saying that there should be no sting operation at all.
As you're dealing with this, I also want you to keep in mind what happened to the professor of Aligarh University. Well, I mean, they actually invaded his bedroom, his privacy, and eventually it's believed that he took his life.
Well, actually, that is a recent case and known to everybody. Worst cases have been there in the sting operation. Like in Agra, a Christian professor was accused of molesting a girl student. And there was a huge crisis, and for 7 days the school was closed and not things happened, and that was a completely wrong kind of an approach of the sting operation. It was only some kind of a very strange and, you know, kind of tendentially released sting operation, and therefore it was quite bad. It was even worse than Aligarh case. So sting operations in absolute terms cannot be condemned, because sometimes sting is necessary, because not only the editor but even the reader or the viewer will say, how do you say that what you are saying is true? So sometimes it is necessary to have this sting operation done, something like tape recorder or something like video recorder or something. But otherwise, sting operation, I would not personally, I have not in my entire editorial career as chief editor of three newspapers, I have not asked anybody to conduct a sting operation, nor have I entertained any sting operation. I said collect the evidence which is otherwise than the sting operation. Because another thing is, in sting operation, there is a distinct possibility that you will sting only the portion that you are seeking.
Yes.
And therefore, you are likely to get the so-called evidence to your argument, but effectively what you are doing is, you are ignoring and neglecting all other aspects of the story particularly, and therefore sting operation is very offensive in that particular respect. Sting operation is also offensive in terms of right to privacy, which is also protected, and so I am not advocate of sting operation. But the other point that Milind was saying is absolutely true, but let us not also underestimate how press influenced by electronic media and later on by social media, went overboard in the 2 years after 2012. Not only on the 2G but even on coal, because when a simple question, as Anand Bhai correctly said, when a single question was put, I think Balla wrote an article that where has this money gone? If you are saying it is a 1,76,000 crores in 2G and 1,86,000 crores in coal block, it is much more than our planning budget of that particular year. Where is this money gone? Who is actually beneficiary of all this money? Because there is no beneficiary. It was all speculative and notional argument of the so-called scam. So on that also, I think press went completely overboard. I think primarily influenced by the electronic media. But again, Indian Express did not go completely overboard. And some other papers also did not go completely overboard. And there are some serious weeklies also. Let us not, you know, ignore them, because those weeklies have done a very good job of putting the things on the map. And therefore, I think overall, I entirely agree with Chairman Mr. Ram Jethmalani that freedom of the press is most important even if it is banned. I know how it is banned from within, but even then, without freedom of the press, I think 26/11 would not have become so important. Imagine only Doordarshan covering 26/11. Imagine only Doordarshan is covering. They would have covered it three times a day, 9 o'clock news, 2 o'clock news and morning news, and we would not have understood the gravity and the seriousness of 26/11 if it was not for 24/7. Maybe there were some, you know, outlandish activities done by some journalists at that time, but that was probably the first coverage of the direct terror, and such mistakes have been made by others. And as far as celebrity cases are concerned, it's not only Indian kind of a disease. O.J. Simpson case in America did exactly the same, and so many cases. Even in England, actually, the press commission at present investigating into Rupert Murdoch case is actually asking these very questions which we are discussing today. How far press has gone, how far press should have gone, how far press should have invaded privacy, because press went on, you know, tapping the holes of the people concerned, and that was quite offensive. So the debate is global, and the debate is global because suddenly in the last 15 years only, the media and social media has also become global, and therefore suddenly hype and heat has gone up. But I don't think it will last long. Perhaps in 5 years, some kind of a heat will be reduced, hype will go on, and people will start suspecting even the media, like they are suspecting even the judiciary today.
Just to add to that, to add to Mr. Kekar, this government recently just gave the author of that CG report a Padma Award.
Harish, I might just say that it's a kind of operation that I think we've got both actually subject matter of judicial determination by the Delhi High Court. One is a sting operation which involves entrapment, and there is another which is a sting operation like we had in the Nanda case, which was to expose an attempt to affect the administration of justice. So in a sense, as Mr. Kekar rightly said, I think that you can't put an absolute on sting operations. But what the Delhi High Court then did was actually to bring about a balance by saying that if there is a sting operation by the media, then the information will not be put out into the media unless it's screened by a committee. So that you then balance, the committee will balance the rights of privacy versus the public interest involved in that particular case. So it depends on what type of sting operation it is, and some of them are absolutely necessary.
And I think that's a very clear definition, right? So if you are going to be a fly on the wall and just sort of know and sort of recorded transactions already happening, then that's, in our view, fair play. If you're going to go and sort of interact with it, like we said, then that's creating news, that's not reporting news.
Ram, I'd like to ask you this. How did we understand the scope of this so-called sub judice rule? To what extent are we limited by it? Is the media limited in commenting upon a matter which is actually undergoing a trial? Because, well, the pleadings are all in the public domain, and surely anyone has a right to say that this ought to be the outcome of a particular case or a trial after reading the evidence. So how far is this sub judice rule relevant in that sense? Because a lot of people use it to avoid answering inconvenient questions by saying, well, this matter is sub judice, I won't get into it. Can you just explain to the audience what the sub judice rule is?
See, the conflict arises between these two matters that you are mentioning, because there is a conflict between two fundamental rights: freedom of expression, which means total press freedom, and on the other side, the rights of an accused person who is fighting for his liberty in a criminal trial. Now, I want members of the audience to know that sometimes a lawyer is blamed for appearing for people whom he believes to be guilty. As a teacher of law, I always tell my students in the classroom of a famous case which took place in England, the case of Adolf Beck. Adolf Beck was a person who was charged by the British government for having defrauded 11 women. His technique was, first he would seduce the woman and start a love affair with her, live with her, and then after some time decamp with all her belongings. 11 women at the trial, and mind you that they were not lying. They were honest women speaking the truth. 11 women came and deposed that he is the man who defrauded us, and nobody in the whole country believed that this man could ever be innocent, except of course his own solicitor. He was sentenced to a very heavy period of imprisonment. And then while this man was undergoing his sentence, the same kind of offense started taking place in England. And the new man was arrested for those offenses, and he confessed not only to the offenses which he had committed, but he also told them that you have put that innocent man in custody in jail, and I have committed those offenses. Now therefore, don't fight with lawyers for the fact because they're going to defend people, because the client is entitled to tell the lawyer that all these witnesses are lying, and please do your job and don't ask these silly questions. And I must tell you that something has got to be done in this direction, but please do not restrict the freedom of expression, which is a more paramount right. The rights under Article 19 are much superior to the rights created by Article 21, and those also are rights of a fair trial created by judicial decision. It's not a right of fair trial is mentioned in any particular article of the Constitution. And therefore, paramountcy is on the side of freedom of speech, and freedom of speech, even if abused by some people, is not a ground for restricting the freedom of press at all. So therefore, I am completely committed to the view that please do not interfere with the freedom of the press, and try and argue with the press, and there should be some honest journalist who will certainly be able to put things right, and the people will ultimately come to believe them.
Just a small point, not directly related but indirectly related to the same issue. You know, this contempt of court is often a big hassle for most of the journalists. I'll give you an actual example. I was chief editor of the Maharashtra Times, and Bharat Thackeray made a statement in Shivaji Park public meeting that a particular judge, he named the judge, particular judge came to him and asked for 35 lakh rupees, and then the judgment will go in Bharat Thackeray's favor or Shivsena's favor. He made that statement with the name of the judge in a public meeting. Next day, my paper, Times-Media, Dina Vakil was the in charge. We published that speech, and we were held for contempt. So that we asked the court, we are held for contempt. Actually, why is it practical? The judge or whoever that it was said, but you published it. You should have been cautious not publishing. Now, this kind of a contempt of court, many contempt of court have been completely irrationally notices are issued to us, and that's why journalists often, you know, become cynical about law or the lawyers or the judges, because they find that it was not being rational or even just. That's why the issue came.
Where they have said that you can't punish anybody unless you prove that he was lying with some malicious intent.
Anand, seeing you here, I can't help but bring up the name of your illustrious grandfather, Ramnath Goenka. I had the pleasure of meeting him, particularly during the emergency. And of course, Ram and Ramnath Goenka were very close buddies, as you tell you. I'm talking about a time when you were not even thought of. But of course, he's been a source of inspiration to anyone, and of course, he upheld the freedom of the press. You know, the first editorial that he did, he just blanked the page out as a protest and refused to fall in line. Now, this is the legacy that you have inherited. I want to know, hypothetically, how would you uphold this freedom? Suppose there was another emergency. I can't really see it happening. I don't know, Bill may answer that a little more pointed. How would you?
That's a tough one, but that's a hypothetical.
Yes.
You know, it was a very different time then. And I think media and sort of consumers of news media have sort of evolved a lot since. And I think we're living in a far more sensitive time. And, you know, since you brought this up, I dug out the archives a little bit because I heard Ramakrishna was coming. And can I just spend 2 minutes reading out one of the most sought after sort of articles in the Express, used to be Ram Jaikmalani's 10 questions to the Prime Minister. I'll just read out a few paragraphs, just be a little patient, bear with me. I see a lot of young people there, so you have to just pay attention. This installment, which contains 10 questions, pertains to a special flight taken by Mr. and Ms. Amitabh Bachchan from Calcutta to the Andaman Islands via Rangoon, and to the Prime Minister's decision to move Mr. VP Singh out of the Finance Ministry. First question, is it correct that Mr. and Mrs. Amitabh, so this is Ram Jaikmalani's questions as published in Indian Express, so Mr. Jaikmalani writing to the Prime Minister. One, is it correct that Mr. and Mrs. Amitabh Bachchan flew from Calcutta via Rangoon to Andaman Island by a special Indian Air Force plane? Two, can you enlighten us as to how and why Mr. Bachchan was permitted this indulgence? Three, particularly can you enlighten us as to who paid the cost of the flight undertaken by the Indian Air Force plane from Calcutta to the Andaman Island via Rangoon? Four, have you seen or are you aware of a letter at one time in the possession of the CBI allegedly written by Fairfax Detective Agency to Mr. Gurumurthy in which there was reference to an alleged investigation by Fairfax into the affairs of the Bachchan brothers? It goes on, then it says, indeed, in the light of the fact the letter has been characterized as a forgery by its addressor and the addressee, why don't you order investigation into the issue? Seven, is it correct that the forged Fairfax letters were shown to you by Mr. Amitabh Bachchan as proof that Mr. VP Singh was using Fairfax to investigate Mr. Progetti and Mr. Amitabh Bachchan himself? Is it not correct that the raid conducted on Mr. Gurumurthy and Mr. Ramnath Goenka of Indian Express was a matter of fact designed to discover any documents that might exist pertaining to the suspected investigation into Mr. Progetti and the Bachchan brothers and yourself? And is it not, and not as is officially alleged, to discover evidence concerning violators of the Official Secrets Act? This article would not make it to any newspaper. No way. We couldn't read all it. So, times have changed, sensitivities have changed. I don't know where, I mean, we are very sensitive to things like defamation. If you have a Bernie Sanders versus Hillary Clinton debate in India today, there will be 5 defamation cases filed amongst the 40 parties. You have a sitting finance minister who's filed a defamation case against a sitting chief minister. last month ago. So I think sensitivity is extremely high. And social media has not helped at all. You know, you're talking about freedom of speech. In America, somebody once said that free speech is a right of every citizen, but free press is a right of anyone who can afford to own one. So what happens is that with social media, all these things don't hold. Anybody has a view, and the anonymity brings out the worst in us, right? So so I think sensitivities have changed. I don't think an emergency today is even possible, to be honest. That's so. To answer your question, I don't think an emergency today is even possible. And you know, if Ramnath Goenka was alive today, he would be on Twitter. And we have the most number of followers, and I don't think it's going to happen right past the first day.
Milan, a question for you. You know, I mean, we've been discussing how far from
the Sorry, I can't answer the question about emergency. I can't speak on behalf of Mr. Modi.
I'm not even asking about that, but you may be able to answer this one. We talked about how powerful the press is. Why does Rahul Gandhi keep away from it?
Well, all I can say is I've deputed Anand now to sort of cajole him to speak a little more to the press. But I think the first experience that he had, unfortunately, didn't go too well. That aside, you know, I mean, there's a section of politicians in India today.
But you know, if you mentored him, I have no doubt that he will come out with flying colors.
I'm not sure if I can mentor him, but thank you. But there's a section of politicians in India who take to these new mediums, technologies, social media, for instance, very easily, like a fish to water, extremely quickly. And that's across age, really. I've seen politicians who are in their late 70s who are very active on social media, who actually sometimes tweet themselves. And then there may be a younger lot who are averse to sort of interacting with media. And I think that's, frankly, it's a very personal choice. To be very fair to Rahul Gandhi, he's always chosen to sort of be very low-key in a sense, versus I think having a very flamboyant kind of image and being extremely engaging with the media. And I personally feel, and I advise him, that it's good for you to engage more with the media. I think it's good for him to be active on social media, to give interviews. But I also think for a politician, whether it was President Obama in the United States, or I believe whether it's Prime Minister Modi today, I think there's a danger of an overkill. And when you tend to over-engage with the media, what you tend to do is you tend to build expectations, you tend to exaggerate what you can do for the people of India, and eventually that just hurts you politically because people get disappointed. And for Mr. Modi's example, today, when he started out and came on the national scene and he announced his candidature for the Prime Minister of India, and he effectively took over the BJP, he was extremely active on social media, he was one of the first entrants to Twitter and Facebook. Today, if you ask me, the expectations that people have from him, largely because he's been over-engaging with the media, is going to be his own unbelief. So I think for a politician, it's very critical and very important to sort of strike a balance. But having said that, I do believe there's a lot of scope for Rahul Gandhi to be far more engaged with the media and with the people of India through these various mediums.
And I think one point needs to be mentioned in this context is that the same and even more violent, I would say, aggressive media strategy was deployed in Bihar by Narendra Modi.